Welcome to China Institute's Blue Cloud Gala. Tonight we celebrate China Institute's 91st anniversary and honor some remarkable individuals whose accomplishments span business, fashion, philanthropy, public service, and culture. They also share the spirit and mission of China Institute to shape positive and strong U.S.-China relations through education, culture, and business. We are so pleased to kick off the festivities with this cocktail reception generously sponsored by H&A Group. In just a few minutes, you will hear from Dr. Yang Guang, CEO of H&A Capital. First, I'm pleased to invite James Hakowitz, President of China Institute, to join me and make some remarks.
Thank you, Didi. I'd like to welcome you all here. We're gonna have a fantastic evening tonight. We're starting off, we actually have 5 honorees, which is a record, I believe, for China Institute. But I'm delighted to kick off the event here with a very, very, very special guest. Lieutenant Governor Kathy Hochul is here to accept an award on behalf of Andrew Cuomo, our governor. And we're so proud of China Institute. We've been around for 91 years, and the fact that we get for a non-government, non-profit, non-political organization. So to have the support of the governments of both the United States, New York City, New York State, and of course China, a big welcome to Ambassador Zhang Qiye, who's here representing China as well. Since Governor Cuomo assumed his office in 2011, he's demonstrated the leadership that makes government work for all the people of New York State. In my view, I call him a beacon of progressive governance. With accomplishments that include passing of marriage equality, a $15 statewide minimum wage, and 12 weeks of paid family leave, to local redevelopment through his upstate revitalization and New York State Regional Council initiatives. But most of all, China Institute is honored to be the recipient of a Regional Economic Development Council Award. I remember when I came in, I was told loud and clear, to be a bridge requires two-way traffic. And I'm so delighted to get the support of both New York State as well as we get from China. Today, in recognition of Governor Cuomo's vision and achievements, I'm privileged to present his Blue Cloud Gala Award to Lieutenant Governor Kathy Hochul, who's accepting this award on the governor's behalf. In her own right, Lieutenant Governor Hochul has been a lifelong advocate for women and families, fighting for equal rights and opportunities for success. She's responsible for championing Governor Cuomo's legislative agenda, and she chairs the New York State Women's Suffrage Commission. She also represented New York's 26th district as a congresswoman, and has worked tirelessly to help on behalf of women and Asian causes. So it's a delight to welcome you up here. Thank you so much, and a big congratulations.
Thank you, James, for that wonderful welcome. And what a pleasure it is to be here tonight with all of you. First of all, someone who I've developed a wonderful friendship with, Ambassador, I want to thank you for extending the hand. When I first became Lieutenant Governor, I think I spent more time with you than my own husband the first year. We made sure I was at the Lunar New Year Parade. I was signing the MOU to develop a formalized relationship between our country and 6 provinces. You've made sure I've been at the Chamber of Commerce events, and you even found your way up to my hometown of Buffalo. So I want to thank you for your incredible leadership. Let's give you a round of applause. I also want to thank H&A for sponsoring this, but also for my number one priority and Governor Cuomo's number one priority, creating jobs in the state of New York. And I said, as you run an airline and hotels and tourism opportunities, you don't need to mention there's 49 other states at all. Just bring them all to New York. We want them to come to our state and enjoy the wonderful experience it is here. I will tell you, just a few hours ago, I was overlooking the Statue of Liberty in Battery Park. I go there for inspiration. And as a reminder to me, knowing I was coming to this event, that the Statue of Liberty first came to life at a time when there was intense Chinese migration to this country. And what an honor it is to now look back and see the accomplishments of how the Chinese have really helped build the fabric of our city and made it the great community that it is. And I so embrace the opportunity to assist businesses, open up doors of trade and commerce between our two countries, to be involved in cultural exchanges, exchanges with students. I had an exchange student from China living with me myself. I have nieces who were born in China. I feel a close personal connection. So while we have strong business, cultural, and educational relationships, what I put the most highest premium on is the personal relationships, and I want to make sure that those only deepen. And our governor has truly made this relationship one of his highest priorities. We have had already 3 trade missions, a 4th is being planned. He made sure that we have trade offices and tourism offices in China, so we have people on the ground to make sure that there is a wide open doorway between our two countries and our cities and your cities as well. So I want to thank you. This is a very, very high honor for our governor, and he will treasure this. And this is a huge recognition. I want to thank you. We have a Governor Cuomo and the people of New York.
Can we have a
45,000 here in the U.S., and thousands of jobs here in New York State, which is in government. And for those who are familiar with our company culture, and we deeply believe in giving back to the society. And so much so, our founders have pledged to donate all their shares to charity. Our recently established charity foundation, Shihang Foundation in New York, is already at work to support the community. We are very happy to partner with China Institute and looking forward to many more together in years to come. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Yan. We must not continue the evening without introducing Ambassador Zhajie, who has really become a friend of China Institute. You've come to almost every event that we have, and you embrace us with your warmth and friendship. So I'd like to introduce you, Ambassador Zhajie.
Good evening, 大家晚上好. Let me just say how happy I am to be here tonight to meet with all the old friends and new friends. And let me first of all say congratulations to China Institute for its 91st years of anniversary. And secondly, I wanted to congratulate all the honorees that are receiving the award. And I think all of them have done so much in this relationship. While speaking after Mr. Yang Guang, while I was listening to your statement and also watching the video, one word came up to my mind, that is connectivity. I think NJAA is a big airliner that has really facilitated connectivity between China and the United States and many other countries. In today's globalized world, I think it is so important for people to be connected, to understand each other, and to become friends. And in this regard, I think China Institute has also contributed so much to another kind of connectivity, that is to connect people together so we can share ideas, to learn from each other, and to learn to respect the culture, history, and the different ways of living and doing things in today's world. And also, I think I would also like to take this opportunity to thank New York State and particularly my good friend, Lieutenant Governor Kathy. I think she's been most supportive of this relationship. She has made all of us, especially our business people, feel welcome here in New York State. And because of the governor and the Lieutenant Governor's hard work, I think actually New York State is really the most favorable destination for Chinese investment and also cooperation. For example, as far as the tourists is concerned, last year we had almost a million Chinese tourists contributing to New York State and New York City economy. So finally, I wanted to say that today, the U.S. and China relationship is the most important relationship to the world. It's not only bringing a lot of benefits to our peoples, but also it has a very positive impact on the world as a whole. So I hope to count on all of you to further support this relationship, and I'm sure that together we can make the best of the relationship out of this. Thank you.
Everybody, we've had enough speeches. It's time for the festivities to begin. So please join me in the room and we'll have our dinner begin. Thank you.
We are dedicated to deepening understanding of China and promoting the U.S.-China cross-cultural dialogue. We do it through the pillars of education, the School of Chinese Studies, culture, our magnificent gallery, and business programming. This may be our 91st year, but our mission, deepening understanding, is more important than ever. In fact, we are playing a crucial role. The two powers must, absolutely must, learn to understand each other and work together to tackle global problems. We at China Institute are working on providing a more nuanced understanding of China, promoting dialogue and conversation that will help anchor the relationship through good times and bad. We are thinking big. With the new space, we are planning a future as the go-to place for all things China, from Chinese language to contemporary art to business exchanges, bringing to life all of the complexity and dynamism that is so apparent in China today. We need your help to achieve our ambitious dreams. As you have just seen in the video, we are building out our spectacular new home at 100 Washington Street. As we continue to raise funds that will allow us to do that, we are thankful for the support we have received from the New York City Department of Cultural Affairs, the Office of Manhattan Borough President, Office of Council Member Margaret Chin, and especially Anne, our trustees. In addition, I am proud to announce this evening that we will receive a leadership gift from the Tong Family Foundation in Hong Kong. Well done. So thank you all for being here and supporting us with this important work. At this time, I would like to introduce James Heimowitz, President of China Institute.
Thank you so much, Dee Dee. It's a delight to be here. Welcome, everybody. 刚刚是我的chairman,他是华人,但是我感觉到他是舒服用英文讲话了,不知道我是不是应该用中文讲话. I'm not sure if I should be speaking English or Chinese, but I want to say a big welcome to everybody. China has changed a lot, a very lot, since I first went there almost 40 years ago. And China Institute is changing too. I hope all of you will come by and get to see everything. As Dee Dee said, it's a magnificent new premises. Lots is going on. 91 years ago, China Institute was founded. And it was small, and it was quaint, and it was charming. The new China Institute is a very different place. The new China Institute has a new demographic. Lots of kids under 30, as well as our old-timers. And whether it's our newly reinvigorated Center for Business, or whether it's the school, or whether it's our classic traditional gallery or cultural programs, the place has a new energy. It's really, really exciting, and I encourage you to come have a visit. Tonight, we've got four more recipients of our Blue Cloud Gala Honor Award. Delighted that they're here to join us. But at this time, before we go any further, I know it's only between me and the meal, I wanted to ask my trustees to stand up. I know Dee Dee's up there, our vice chair, our chair. An Le Cheng, where's An Le Cheng? Sophia Sheng, our development committee chair. Yi Sai Khan and Zeme, this evening's amazing gala co-chairs. Chen Guo Qing, Yuan Ming, James Chin, Michael Krupa, Yvonne Wong, Ingrid Ehrenberg, and Judy Grimes-Muller. I would also like to thank the supporter of this year's Blue Cloud Gala, HNA Group, for so generously supporting our cocktail reception, and all our gala committee hosts, McAndrews and Forbes, Bank of America, An Le Cheng and Mark Kingdon, China Construction America, United Airlines, James Chin and Gail Ong, Macquarie Capital, Plaza Construction, Sophia and Abel Shung, Vera Wang, the China General Chamber of Commerce, and Perfect World. It's a long list and it's growing, and I'm so proud that we're getting support. As I said, we're a non-government organization. We're non-profit and we're non-political. And that we have the support and we have the backing and we have the real commitment from governments, both in New York City, New York State, and federal government, as well as the Chinese government, means so much to me and to China Institute. One more thing, before I get to introduce my angel trustees, I call them, this evening's co-chairs, we've been given a citation from New York State, the New York State Assembly, and our newly elected assembly person, assembly member, Niu Yi Lin, is here. Where is she? Please come up. We're so delighted to receive the support of New York State, and I'm delighted to welcome up Niu Yi Lin.
Hello, everyone. I just wanted to say welcome to my beautiful, amazing, diverse, and incredibly resilient district, which is Lower Manhattan. So thank you so much for coming.
Thank you for coming.
We know a couple of days ago we had a pretty big tragedy happen here in Lower Manhattan. The world was shaken again, and you know, I just wanted to recognize that for a second, because you know, my district is incredible. It's diverse, it's resilient, it's beautiful, it's full of incredibly strong people. And you know, we have an incredible new addition, which is the China Institute, which is bringing us that cultural unity and cultural experience and cultural richness that makes the conversation all the better for our state. So I just want to thank you guys for being here and coming down here, and always, you know, we want to honor the folks who bring that cultural richness to our conversation in the state. So this assembly citation, which I brought all the way down from Albany, is for all of you in honor of your Blue Cloud Gala.
Thank you so much. You know, the narrative about China that we hear in the United States is not always smack on. In fact, it often can be warped and distorted. So China Institute's mission is really to let people experience China firsthand, whether it's the amazing singers you've just heard and you'll hear more from Tibet, whether it's a business meeting, for example, tomorrow. Ronald Perlman, thank you very much for having our tomorrow's Global Council for CEOs in your boardroom, or whether it's an exhibit that comes directly from China. It's so important for Americans to have a deeper and more nuanced understanding and appreciation of what's really happening in China. So before I go on, I know that we're about to get started. I have my angel trustees here, Yu Sai Khan and He Mei, who are this evening's gala co-chairs. A big warm welcome for the rest of the evening to our gala co-chairs and MC, Yu Sai and He Mei.
Hi, I am Yu Sai Khan. And with me is Linda He Mei. She's my co-chair and my co-MC tonight. Now, you may not know much about He Mei, but it's somebody that I really admire, because she, from nothing, built a business into a very big enterprise. She's the largest CB5 operator in China. Welcome, He Mei.
大家好，我是何梅，很高兴今天在这里和大家一起庆祝华媒的91周年。
It is amazing. It is really amazing what a small little group of dedicated people can do. You know, it was just only 2 years ago that we moved from the uptown to downtown. When we moved to downtown, we literally had to start from zero. It is totally extraordinary what these people have done. We thank very much tonight. We particularly thank you very much for coming to support us. Tonight, I want you to be prepared to be inspired. During the cocktail hour, we already honored Governor Cuomo. Later on, we are going to honor four truly outstanding individuals. They are Mr. Ron Perlman, the talented Vera Wang, but a very, very small one. Please, please be our angels. Help us with your generosity that will allow us to grow into what we like to be. We need your help for construction funds to complete our vast space. Once we have that space, we know that there are so many things we can accomplish. So please, please be generous. So be generous to us, so we know that we are not alone. Now, I want you to be prepared to be entertained. Now, earlier in the program, you already enjoyed some amazing singer, right? The singing by three amazing girls. We actually flew them in from a very remote village in the Aba Tibetan Prefecture in the Sichuan Province, Southwest China. Now, you all know that Sichuan province is where Hainan Airlines is flying to, right? And tomorrow we'll fly direct to China, okay? Into Sichuan province. These are the three sisters known as the Snow Lotus Trio. Some call them the three Chinese treasures. To tell you how remote they live, we have to send a car to this place to pick them up, to take them to the airport. Tonight, you will enjoy the kind of ethnic folk song indigenous to that beautiful part of China.
是的，今天我们很高兴地请到了雪莲三姐妹作为我们的表演嘉宾。这三位藏族的姐妹来自于四川的哈坝县的一个非常遥远的小村子。 你们是不是已经被他们的美貌和才华震撼到了？好，我来问一下。你们觉得你们好，觉得你们怎么样？
We would like to know a little bit about what they wear, shall we? Yeah, I really would like to know that. 你今天穿的是什么呢？这个服装是我们家乡那边比较盛装，算是盛装。 This is what we wear when we are in Tibet, wear when we go to festivals.
这个腰带，the
bells, the beads, the earrings.
然后还有很多，这一半多的都没带过来。
We actually wear a lot more than this, but because of the long distance, we could not bring that much.
来过，来过。纽约怎么样？How
do you like New York?
很好，很漂亮。Very
beautiful。晚上的夜景特别漂亮。And the night view of New York is exceptional.
我们昨天晚上用那个手机拍了，然后放在那个朋友圈里面，家人和朋友都看了，都觉得特别漂亮。Oh,
that last night they went out in the night and they took a lot of pictures and sent it back to their villages. And their friends were totally amazed how beautiful New York is.
能不能介绍一下你们的音乐？对，等一等，我再问你一个问题，好吧？
I want to ask you. They're very famous in China. I want to know where they have performed before. 你们全世界去过多少个国家？
有去过法国、加拿大、比利时、卢森堡、韩国、日本、美国来过，其他好多城市。
美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城市。美国来过，其他好多城 OK， 那你们能够介绍一下你们的音乐吗？ Can you explain a little bit of your music to us？
我们是从来没有学过音乐知识的。
We never ever studied music before.
然后我们的民族是一个特别能歌善舞的民族。
We are a nationality that can really sing and dance.
我们唱的是原生态的，就是传承我们老一辈的歌曲。
We sing songs that were passed on by our ancestors.
在我们那儿有个说法，就是说，会走路就会跳舞，会说话就会唱歌。
In our place, in our area, we say that the moment we can walk, we can dance, and the moment we can talk, we can sing.
那好，你们今天要唱什么？我们下面唱一首我们老一辈的一首歌，带给大家是一首阿弥阿哄，就是吉祥的经。
This is an old song in our area. It's called 阿弥阿哄。 What is 什么是阿弥阿哄？阿弥阿哄是一个吉祥的酒歌。
带一点吉祥酒歌的感觉，就是特别吉祥的日子里面唱的一首。
In a very very auspicious day, they sing this song to encourage you to drink. So you better drink up.
Okay.
那我们就听你唱喽。
OK. 因为家乡的民歌是没有伴奏的，都是以清唱的形式。
They want you to understand that in a natural state, this is how they sing. Without musical accompaniment. That's how they sing in Tibet.
So,
谢谢。 Thank you, enjoy.
for China Institute. You have heard Yu Saikang and James Heimowitz, our president, with all the accomplishments that we have done so far, but we still need more support. Can I get the room more quiet, please? Quiet. Hello? Okay, so we want to transform ourselves further and become a modernized China Institute to show you all that new things that's happening in China. So one of the new initiatives we have started is fashion. And so you see today, I am modeling one of the Chinese fashion designers' outfits. So we have a new fashion initiative, and we're going to have a fashion gala on May 4th at the Plaza Hotel. So hope you'll get tickets and come join us. So we have a 4月4号有一个时尚晚会, 希望你们大家买票来赞助我们. Okay, so China Institute's dream is to build out our ground floor. So we have a window to the world to let people learn about China through contemporary art, through technology exhibits, through fashion shows or performances. So we need help in constructing this ground floor. And we need a staircase to get to the heart of China Institute, which is on the second floor, where people can learn about the culture and business of China and all the current events. So this is just not just any old staircase. It is the future of China Institute. So I hope you will generously help us to construct it. And Geraldine Nagel from Sotheby's will tell you how about the pledge.
Thank you so much. I have only been here just, what, about an hour this evening, and I am so inspired by the work that the China Institute does. I'm so inspired by the vision that they have with their new building and their new space. So it gives me great pleasure tonight to be here wearing my Sotheby's hat to help the China Institute raise the funds that it takes to sort of finish off this year's mission. You've heard quite a bit about their new building here downtown and how they're trying to build out these spaces and this fabulous staircase here. So the first thing we're going to do tonight is try to build this staircase. So if I could just ask you for one moment to look on your tables, and in your programs, there's a menu card, just like this. If you turn it over, there you go, I see everybody, that's great, great work. On the back side is a pledge card. There are pens on the table, and I'm gonna walk you through and talk you through some initiatives that we're hoping to achieve tonight in order to create this vision and fulfill the connections of the China Institute. So you see behind me this fabulous staircase that's going to go through the floors of the building. The cost of the staircase is approximately $400,000. These aren't just any steps, they're beautiful granite steps. And those of us in the art world aren't great mathematicians, but that basically breaks down to about $10,000 a step. So if I could be very bold and invite some of you this evening to fill out your card with a $10,000 pledge. Are there any in the room tonight who will write $10,000 toward creating this fantastic granite staircase? Any pledges of $10,000? Thank you. I see one card right here in the air in the center, the gentleman at $10,000. Thank you, sir. A volunteer is right on their way to help you. Anyone else is $10,000? For the staircase, $10,000. We have one pledge in the center of the room at $10,000. And anyone else? Well, as the Chinese say, a journey of 1,000 li, or miles, with single steps, and each step needs a riser. So who will pledge $5,000 toward helping us build the risers? Pledges of $5,000, a gentleman in the back there at $5,000. Just fill out your card, please, and a volunteer will come and get you. Your card, $5,000, a lady over here is a thank you say, in red, it's red here, on my right, $5,000, two hands in the air. Yes, just take your cards and fill them in. It looks like we have three pledges here at $5,000. Anyone else at $5,000? Thank you, sir. On my left, at table five. At table number five, there's a gentleman pledging toward the risers of $5,000. Anyone else is 5,000? So we are definitely taking our first steps in this journey, but the stairwell continues. And in every beautiful stairwell such as this needs railings. And the railings are made of beautiful steel and glass, and they're gonna cost about a total of $50,000. So we can't have people falling down the stairs as they're rushing to their Chinese classes and to the fabulous events that are going on. So who will offer $2,500 toward helping to build the railing? I'm looking for pledges of $2,500. Any pledges of $2,500 toward the railing on the staircase? Right here in the scene.
So this photo is available for a silent auction. So it is in that part of the alcove. So if you like the photo, this photo, please go and make a pledge, okay? And lastly, we want to show you, this is also in our next show. It shows what the artist is showing how China is modernizing so fast. So all these industrial things, you think it's scenery, but it's made of a lot of industrial structures. So it's a very poignant exhibit. So it's showing you the rapid modernization of China and how people have to think about the social and economic impacts that are happening in China. And we are going to have a lot of programs that has discussed this topic, and the series is going to call Searching for the Soul of China. So it's going to be a wonderful exhibit. I think we, instead of taking up more time and let you have dinner, we'll just let you fill out the cards, all right? You know, just instruction. And so,
so just a reminder, starting in February, this fabulous show, which is called The Art of the Mountain, some examples of which you've seen here, is going to open. And there are various efforts that need to be taken care of in order to ensure that this show is as much of a success as the one you saw in the Han Dynasty and the Jade Suit. So to give you an idea, you know, to create the catalog is $40,000. Obviously, we need to fly over scholars and photographers for these fantastic symposiums that we're having at the China Institute. So again, ladies and gentlemen, you have the cards in front of you. No amount is too small. As you're enjoying your meal tonight, if you're thinking, what more could you do to this fabulous effort that is right here in New York and furthering all the relationships between China and America, now is the time to leave a pledge, leave a donation. The volunteers will come around, or you can hand it in as you leave. So thank you all very much, and enjoy the rest of your evening.
We're going to start doing our award ceremony. But before I do the award ceremony, I was asked to show you something in a silent auction. There are six pieces of jade. This is not normal jade. For me, anything from Han Dynasty that is 2,000 years old is extremely precious. This is in our silent auction over there. I hope that before you leave, you have a chance to see it over there, on the table over there. I just want to recognize that Mr. and Mrs. Wender and table 24, I believe. Can you wave your hands? This is from the Jade Suit. This is extremely, extremely rare. We want to thank them very much for the wonderful donation they've given to us. Thank you for your support. Now we start our award ceremony. Our first honoree is Ron Perlman. You know, we women are very close to Ron.
Tell you the secret, my idol for many, many, many years. I tell you why. At the beginning, when we came to from China to United States in New York City, even that time, everybody knows Ron Perlman is such a giant in the business world. And as a Jewish boy, he loves money. He made a lot. But he also has a very big heart. It's not a question of only making money. It's how you give money back to the society. So Ron is not only my idol of making money, but also giving back to the society. That is the part, the secret of Ron's success. His personality, his business judgment, or importantly, he's a very big Jewish heart. And I'm sorry to say, I have to say, he was my idol for business many, many, many years ago. He today is my idol of philanthropy. Because I'm a little bit ashamed. Today, tonight, here, in the Chinese Institute, we have so many successful Chinese people. They had a hard time to auction a few pieces. Please give. You know how to make money now? Give back to society. Most important tonight, give back to the Chinese Institute. Help China Institute. But, wrong. The award tonight is not only a acknowledgement of your success, both as a business leader and a philanthropist, but also in the invitation for you, please bring your wisdom, bring your heart, bring your skills, and come to join a bigger society, which is China. I had a dream. When I was born, I want to come to America. In a way, I achieved my own dream. But now, there's a bigger world, the global village, and China is a big part. So Ron, please bring your wife, who has never been to China, you've only been once. We are going many, many times. Ladies and gentlemen, I was doing a sales mission, but the real Ron Perlman is here in the video for the next few minutes. Please pay attention.
His presence on earth benefits somebody. Sometimes it feels like he makes money just to give it away, but actually his thinking is the gift.
Ronald Perlman has spent a lifetime building great businesses and giving back to the communities he loves.
Billionaire financier Ron Perlman.
All we have to say is it's Ronald Perlman, and he's here, and we're grateful. You run more than a dozen companies.
With McAndrews and Forbes, he has established himself as one of the most successful businessmen of his generation in businesses as diverse as cosmetics and entertainment, biotechnology and gaming. Ronald Perlman has made an enduring mark, but what truly drives Ronald Perlman is a love of helping his fellow man.
One of the things we've been really stressing at Columbia is entrepreneurship and tech. And Ronald's very generous gift for Center for Business Innovation.
Establishing the Ronald O. Perlman Center for Business Innovation at Columbia University. University's Business School and the Perelman Center for Political Science and Economics at his alma mater, the University of Pennsylvania. As one of the world's most generous philanthropic donors, Mr. Perelman supports the best of the arts and culture.
Ronald opens up his home, his network, and most importantly, his heart to keep the doors of one of America's most important cultural institutions open.
In his home of New York City, he made a $75 million gift to fund the Performing Arts Center at the World Trade Center.
The Performing Arts Center is going to be an amazing place, a reflection of performances from around the world.
Ron was one of the first to partner with the 9/11 Memorial. He just said, what do you need? Next day we had a check.
Ronald Perelman's contributions in the world of medicine have been truly transformational.
A remarkable gift to the medical community today. $50 million, including the establishment of the New Heart Institute to treat cardiac disease and another in support of reproductive infertility research.
Perhaps Ronald's most extraordinary legacy, one that has already saved millions of lives, is the creation of the Revlon UCLA Women's Cancer Research Program, which led to the development of her widely regarded as the most important development in the treatment of breast cancer in the last 50 years. Ronald O. Perelman has built businesses that lead their industries, but his greatest leadership is in the profoundly far-reaching and impactful acts of giving made possible by his success. He is a man that lives to serve his community and to make certain his life's work improves the lives of others all across the world.
Ladies and gentlemen, Ronald Perelman, a great businessman, a great philanthropist with a big heart, and more importantly, a father of 8 children. Ronald Perelman. The one and the only one.
First of all, how do you say bologna in Chinese?
It costs honey bologna.
Well, thank you very much for that introduction. It's a little bit bloated, but it's very welcome to me. Thank you very much. I am truly honored and thrilled to be here tonight with you this evening. I went to China for the first time, as Cyrus said, about 6 months ago. And I was blown away with what I saw. The culture, the energy, the quality of the people, the attitude, the drive for success, the warmth, and the commonality of interest to work not only for the benefit of China, but for the benefit of the relationship between China and America. There was not one executive that we met with, and we met with probably 24, whose first position was not stated to be, let's find ways to work together for our two countries. I have long believed, and believe even more firmly today, that China is our most important partner in the world.
Yes.
And after tonight, I realized that the Chinese are really Jewish. So.
Ron, we call it Jewish.
I think that we need each other, China and America, for security, for economics, for cultural exchange and for development, and to protect the planet, because together we can do it, apart we can't. And one of the reasons that I am so thrilled and honored to be here this evening is because of the fine work that this institute is doing and bringing to all of us in America and in China the awareness of how important this relationship is. Years ago, I met C.H. Tong, who was then either the informal or formal sort of liaison between the Chinese and the American business community. And he said to me back then, this is a relationship that we must build for the future of the world. And it is coming more vividly aware to all of us every day. And I would just like to commit to the China Institute that, first of all, I just want to say one other thing before I forget. I have never felt so warm and comfortable at an event that I've ever been to in my life. So I thank you very, very much for making me feel so, thank you, so good and welcoming and generous. And I think that is one of the unique attributes of the Chinese people that that is so important to us in America and to the world. And I would just like to commit myself here this evening to do everything I can on behalf of the Institute and myself and our entities to do anything I can to bring about a continued and growing relationship between the two countries. I thank you very, very much. I really, truly appreciate this, and I love you.
Welcome, Ron Perlman, to the World of China.
Isn't he something? Ron Perlman is an amazing human being. We are, China Institute, we are really very honored that he's here, to be honored. Our second honoree is Vera Wang. I remember I interviewed Vera Wang for my TV show in the 80s when she first started her own brand. She's laughing right now over there. I was fascinated. I was fascinated by this very brave young woman, Chinese woman no less. You see, in those days, there was no Chinese brand, let alone Chinese designers. Then, of course, from then to now, a lot has happened. Today, Vera is everywhere in the world. She's one of the few people whose website, when you get on it, will ask you, which country of Vera Wang would you like to get to? Try it. Go to verawang.com. But no matter how big Vera has become today, some things never changed. She is, just as the first day I met her, still a kind, accommodating, generous, and extremely gracious woman. We are very, very proud of her. Very proud of her being Chinese too. And thank you very much for taking this honor. Let's take a look at a video about Vera.
I think what I have brought to fashion in my own way is an attitude, which is I really want to encourage, not dictate. And by that I mean I want to encourage every single woman to explore who she is and how she wants to look and to feel that freedom and that creativity and that fun. Sense of joy and fun that fashion will bring to their lives. It's not just about sitting in a design room where you're dreaming. It's about the attitude that, of course, being a woman designer for other women is such a special journey because I relate to clothing in a personal way on a whole other level. I feel that women are sensual creatures. I feel that clothes should make them feel that way. I don't care if it's a great pea coat, the way they wear it should have attitude and they should feel comfortable in it. Because to me, fashion is about attitude. It's not only about clothing and accessories. It's how it affects a woman, how feels when she's in it. These are all personal journeys. To me, when a woman understands who she is and who she isn't, then she can really create a style for herself that's authentic. I think I'm very lucky because I do design in so many domains. No matter what the product is, it's who is the woman you're thinking of. It's not just about the clothing or the accessories. Who is that person and how do you make them look their best? I think that's what makes the entire design process and the journey complete, is that it says a lot about the woman, and that to me is what design really is about.
Thank you, Cy, for that lovely introduction, and you honored me with your presence. And thank you, Dee Dee, for presenting me with this incredible award. My personal gratitude should also go out to my dear friend, who's not here tonight, I didn't realize, Miranda Tang, whose grace and dignity know no bounds. Gallic Chair Mehi, I hope I'm pronouncing this correct because I do speak Mandarin, but I hope I'm pronouncing it correctly. And of course, the China Institute. President James Himovitz, I don't want to make a Jewish joke, but I did ask him when I arrived tonight, how did you get involved with the Chinese? And he was so adorable. And of course, the Board of Trustees. And finally, my fellow honorees, Ronald Perlman, very dear friend, Robert Zhao, I hope I'm presenting that correctly, and Nin Yang. Congratulations to such an extraordinary and deserving group of individuals. Being here tonight reminds me of so many things, but most of all, my own personal history. Growing up in the United States, it was my parents, Chen Qing and Florence, who encouraged me to embrace American culture, while never allowing me to forget my Chinese heritage. That delicate balance was what provided my brother Ken and I with such a unique view of the world and a sincere appreciation for both cultures. As the Chinese Institute expresses so beautifully and succinctly in its mission statement, bridging the United States and China by sharing insights and deepening trust through pillars of education, culture, and business. And trust, for me, is a significant word. As someone who has witnessed so much this half a century, these many decades, and realize the opportunities I was afforded, China Institute embodies that and way more, and truly reflects everything I was so fortunate to have experienced in my lifetime. And for that, I will always be grateful. The world we once knew has changed radically. However, today, there is an even greater need for deeper thought, open communication, and true authenticity. Respect for others is the only way I know to create a safer, happier, and more prosperous future. China Institute has always been the forefront of these ideals, the significance of which we must all embrace, not just for our generation, but those that follow in our footsteps. It is our duty. You are all part of that journey. I am so honored to be honored by all of you here tonight, and I thank you for this incredible recognition. Thank you.
Thank you. Take a picture. Do you want to take pictures?
Yes.
Okay, now I would like to introduce you to our Vice Chair of China Institute, Anna Chang.
Hello, again. It's hard to follow Silas, Ron, Vera, USI, but I'm going to try. Our next Blue Card Award honoree is Robert Hong Xiao. Many of you may not be familiar with his name, but you may be very familiar with his company, Perfect World. He is the CEO of Perfect World, a giant in the world of online gaming. One of the largest gaming companies in China, with products exported to more than 100 countries and regions around the world, he is best known in China, but best known amongst your children. You ask them if you know any of those games, they would know what Robert is providing them. Most importantly, since he became CEO in 2012, Robert has built Perfect World from an ordinary Chinese public company into a global enterprise representing the highest level of online games in China. He is also driving a cutting-edge innovation with the opening of a series of research institutes in China. He's very interested in studying the brain, and in fact, he had a series of lectures and studies collaboration with Columbia University to understand the brain of elderly. He's also pursuing a next-generation internet entertainment technology research institute, a digital arts institute, a global digital entertainment development research center, and a China Digital Arts Association. The purpose of these new centers of digital innovation is to train new talent in digital entertainment and promote an industrial and technological revolution in innovation in digital entertainment. Finally, Robert is extremely philanthropic and has brought Perfect World to a leadership position in Chinese corporate social responsibility. The Perfect World Employee Foundation makes charitable contributions to public welfare works and projects including disaster relief, helping dropout and disabled children, and building Perfect World villages in the poor areas of Yunnan province. With a PhD from the University of Southern California, Robert is deeply committed to cross-cultural understanding. I personally know that Robert really cares about U.S.-China relations, and in fact, when I asked him, what brings you to New York? Do you have business here? He said, no, most of his business is on the West Coast, but he really wanted to be here to receive the award and to really be a role model to promote U.S.-China relations. I believe he literally embodies China Institute's mission of building bridges between the U.S. and China. And please turn your attention to the screen for a video about Robert.
Founded in 2004, Perfect World Company Limited has exported its multiple entertainment contents to more than 100 countries and regions, and has set up more than 20 subsidiaries in operation in North America, Europe, and Asia. Perfect World has become the largest movie and game conglomerate ever in China. In the film and TV industry, Perfect World Pictures has filmed many award-winning movies and produces around 500 episodes of TV series every year, which accounts for over 10% of primetime TV in China. TV series of Perfect World Pictures were offered to Argentina as national gifts by President Xi during his visit in 2014. For Game Center, Perfect World Games has successfully developed and released multiple quality games and operated many globally known esports titles in China. For several continual years,
Perfect World Games has won first place in China's Game Expo with the leading superiority. As the CEO of the company, Dr. Shao has delivered speeches and joint discussions at multiple major international conferences, such as the World Economic Forum, Boao Forum for Asia, APEC Summits, and World Internet Conference. He speaks for the rising cultural and creative industry and contributes insights to the development of world economy and social harmony and stability. In the future, Dr. Shao will always devote himself to multicultural exchanges and mutual learning, focused on creating and spreading happiness to the public.
Just arrived from China last night, so it was a little jet lag. Oh, this afternoon, sorry. This is great form. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Alan. Thank you very much. And thank you, Mr. Bay, our chairman. And thank you, James, my friend. And thank you for the Board of Trustees here. I'm a little busy still, but try to remember what I supposed to say. We are a young company compared to many successful businesses here in the United States. You know, I'm thrilled to receive this award, be recognized. This is not about me, obviously. This is about, I guess, a generation of different business people from China who wanted to reach out to the world and to do something more than just earning profit and generating good business returns. I think it's been very inspirational, you know, in listening to whatever Ronald has been saying and doing. You know, this is, I probably need to dig a little bit more and understand how, you know, leaders like Ronald can become a leader. Not only in the business, but also in philanthropic activities. And Vera, of course, you know, I'm a fan of you always. And other really distinguished honorees. I'm thrilled. I think what we have been doing, it's something probably new, besides some of the successes in the businesses around the world. What we were trying to do are twofold. One is on the education for youth, especially for youngsters in China, because we all know there are many poor, very poor places in the remote areas of China. We not only donate money, we not only help them to build schools, but also we send people. We are an entertainment firm, so we have a lot of talent. We send our talent to go to, you know, to do some voluntary work by teaching kids the art. This is well received, and our employees are really really appreciating this, because you know what, even in poor places, people are honored to be able to help other people. I've been visiting a lot of poor places, visiting young kids, and I'm deeply moved every time I'm there. The second poll we've been trying to do is it's probably related to my background. I want to really promote a lot of culture exchanges, bilateral, multilateral, exchanges by people. We're business people, so we don't do much. We can't do much in political things. We understand that the world need to be peacefully developed, and understanding between cultures, between nations, between ethnic groups, very important. So what we're trying to do always is to utilizing our resources to help different people from different countries, from different, you know, religious backgrounds get together and understand each other. Exchange the best part of their own culture. I believe we haven't done much yet. There are a lot of more to do. And I'm very, very lucky and I feel honored to be able to get involved with China Institute with good people like this and you know, try to work together to make good things happen for both China and the US. Because, you know, sitting today, getting this reward is not the end. It definitely is a start. And I think we need to join force. We need to work together. A lot of people are asking me what Perfect World means. Angela was asking me, you know, how she could get into Perfect World. Everybody wants to live in a perfect world. Obviously, I said, we're not perfect. Nobody is perfect. Our company is not perfect at all. But I think, I always think, if we can work together, we can join force. We have our heart together. We can always make this world truly perfect. Thank you very much. Thank you.
I have the honor to, since you already know me, I don't need to be introduced, but I have the honor to introduce the next honoree, the next and last honoree, Ning Yuan, whom I know, of course, as Yuan Ning. But Yuan Ning is at the very forefront of China's efforts to create world-class multinational companies that are operating in markets all across the world. China State Construction and Engineering Corporation is the largest construction company in the world. So of course, in my business as an architect, I run into them all the time. They have built my buildings in many, many cities, in Beijing, in Qingdao, even in Washington. CCA participated in the project that we did in Washington. China Construction America has become a major player in the US infrastructure and high-end building market. CCA has sustained an annual growth rate of more than 40%. I think even Mr. Perlman would be impressed with numbers like that. From constructing buildings for Chinese diplomatic missions to undertaking projects for Chinese companies operating overseas, from providing turnkey construction solutions to public and private clients, to participating in projects through investment and financial consulting, CCA has opened a path to continue expanding its business and partnering with American companies to explore opportunities overseas. At CCA, Ning Yuan has embraced far-sighted localization strategy, incorporating elements of both Eastern and Western management approaches for leadership. CCA's commitment to long-term partnership and integrity has been a major contributor to CCA's success, offering valuable lessons to other Chinese companies interested in entering the US market. But Ning Yuan's contributions extend far beyond the realm of pure business acumen. Through both his CCA business and his work at the Chinese General Chamber of Commerce, Ning Yuan has helped to promote dialogue and exchange between Chinese and US business leaders. This kind of collaboration and dialogue between Chinese and American businesses provides crucial non-government linkages that help ensure that the U.S. and China continue to work together to find solutions for mutual challenges. I would also like to add that we are extremely happy to welcome Ningyuan as a new member of our Board of Trustees. So his contributions go well beyond just the business part. So I invite you to look at the video, and then we'll meet Ningyuan.
Ningyuan, Chairman and President of China Construction America, China State Construction Engineering Corporation's largest overseas subsidiary, is a veteran in international construction and investment. Shouldering the largest investment and construction group CSCEC's global vision, Mr. Yuan has dedicated his entire career to the company's overseas development. Mr. Yuan successfully transformed CCA from a small Chinese contractor of just 12 employees to a multinational company in the Americas. Under Mr. Yuan's leadership, the company has maintained an average annual growth rate of over 55% in the past decade, and more than 98% of its employees are local hires. Today, CCA is recognized as the 10th largest bridge contractor and the second largest builder in South Florida and fourth largest in New York City. Due to Mr. Yuan, CSCEC's first international acquisition came when CCA purchased Plaza Construction in 2014, which has enhanced CSCEC's global presence significantly and put the company in a more competitive position in the United States. China Construction America has also successfully expanded into the Caribbean and Latin American markets with a strong presence in the Bahamas and Panama. Mr. Yuan initiated and succeeded in establishing CCA's investment and development platform to serve the company's business expansion in the Americas. In addition to being a successful businessman, Mr. Yuan is a keen educator, committed to supporting quality education, and the initiator of all CCA's charitable activities. Mr. Yuan travels to many prestigious universities to mentor young talents with his industry expertise inspirational vision. Mr. Yuan served as the third and fourth chairman of China General Chamber of Commerce in the United States, and he is a passionate supporter of a healthy and comprehensive China-U.S. relationship, making significant contributions to bilateral economic exchanges.
Thank you, Didi, for your kind words. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm humbled and honored to accept this award and to join the other four honorees who have made incredible contribution to China-U.S. relations. It gives me great pleasure and honor to work alongside all of you to advance this extremely important bilateral relationship in the world. To China Institute, thank you for this award and for the wonderful opportunity to get together and renew our friendship and commitment to a healthy and productive U.S.-China relationship. I also want to express my gratitude to all those present or not who have helped and supported me over the years. It takes more than one lap to prop up a house, so thank you for being there for me along the way. Last but not least, I'd like to thank each and every one of the 2,000 CCA employees. Without their hard work and dedication, CCA could hardly have reached where it is now. I know Didi and James will back me up on this as CCA's subsidiary, Plaza Construction, has just completed China Institute's new headquarters. In Chinese, we say, 不忘初心方得始终, meaning that staying true to your original aspiration will lead you to success. As China has entered a new era of going out, let's stay true, press on, for a better and more prosperous future that benefits both China and the United States. Thank you.
Every one of us in the fashion business looks at Silas as the godfather of fashion. Everything he touches seems to turn into gold. Am I not right, Ronald?
Yes.
At the very least, he took two little brands called Tommy Hilfiger and Michael Kors and made them mega, mega brands all over the world. And Silas is very philanthropic. It seems every event I go to is sponsored by him. We really love this man. So here is Silas Chow.
This is about Channing Institute. And ladies and gentlemen, this is the greatest moment tonight. I have the honor to present Romper. Okay, Romperman has been, I tell you the secret, my idol for many, many, many years. I tell you why. At the beginning, when we came to from China to United States in New York City, even that time, everybody knows Ron Perlman is such a giant in the business world. And as a Jewish boy, he loves money, and he made a lot of money. But he also has a very big heart. It's not a question of only making money. It's how you give money back to the society. So, Ron is not only my idol of making money, but also giving back to the society. That is the part, the secret of Ron's success. His personality, his business judgment, or importantly, he's a very big Jewish heart. And I'm sorry to say, I have to say, he was my idol for business many, many, many years ago. He today is my idol of philanthropy. Because I'm a little bit ashamed. Today, tonight, here, in the Chinese Institute, we have so many successful Chinese people. They had a hard time to auction a few pieces. Please give. You know how to make money now? Give back to society. Most important tonight, give back to the Chinese Institute. Help Chinese Institute. But, wrong. The world tonight is not only a acknowledgement of your success, both as a business leader and a philanthropist, but also in the invitation for you, please bring your wisdom, bring your heart, bring your skills, and come to join a bigger society, which is China. I had a dream when I was born. I want to come to America. In a way, I achieved my own dream. But now, there's a bigger world, the global village, and China is a big part. So Ron, please bring your wife, who has never been to China, you've only been once. We are going many, many times. Ladies and gentlemen, I was doing a sales mission, but the real Ron Perlman is here in the video for the next few minutes. Please pay attention.
His presence on Earth benefits somebody. Sometimes it feels like he makes money just to give it away, but actually his thinking is the gift.
Ronald Perlman has spent a lifetime building great businesses and giving back to the communities he loves.
Billionaire financier Ron Perlman.
All we have to say is it's Ronald Perlman, and he's here, and we're grateful. You run more than a dozen companies.
With McAndrews and Forbes, he has established himself as one of the most successful businessmen of his generation in businesses as diverse as cosmetics and entertainment, biotechnology and gaming. Ronald Perlman has made an enduring mark, but what truly drives Ronald Perlman is a love of helping his fellow man.
One of the things we've been really stressing at Columbia is entrepreneurship and tech. And Ronald's very generous gift for Center for Business Innovation.
Establishing the Ronald O. Perlman Center for Business Innovation at Columbia University's Business School and the Perlman Center for Political Science and Economics at his alma mater, the University of Pennsylvania. As one of the world's most generous philanthropic donors, Mr. Perlman supports the best of the arts and culture.
Ronald opens up his home, his network, and most importantly, his heart to keep the doors of one of America's most important cultural institutions open.
In his home of New York City, he made a $75 million gift to fund the Performing Arts Center at the World Trade Center.
The Performing Arts Center is going to be an amazing place, a reflection of performances from around the world.
Ron was one of the first to partner with the 9/11 Memorial.
He just said, what do you need? Next day we had a check.
Ronald Perlman's contributions in the world of medicine have been truly transformational.
A remarkable gift to the medical community today. $50 million, including the establishment of the New Heart Institute to treat cardiac disease and another in support of reproductive and fertility research.
Perhaps Ronald's most extraordinary legacy, one that has already saved millions of lives, is the creation of the Revlon UCLA Women's Cancer Research Program, which led to the development of her widely regarded as the most important development in the treatment of breast cancer in the last 50 years. Ronald O. Perlman has built businesses that lead their industries, but his greatest leadership is in the profoundly far-reaching and impactful acts of giving made possible by his success. He is a man that lives to serve his community and to make certain his life's work improves the lives of others all across the world.
Ladies and gentlemen, Ron Perlman, a great businessman, a great philanthropist with a big heart, and more importantly, a father of 8 children. Ron Perlman. The one and the only one.
First of all, how do you say bologna in Chinese?
It costs honey bologna.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for that introduction. It's a little bit bloated, but it's very welcome to me. Thank you very much. I am truly honored and thrilled to be here tonight with you this evening. I went to China for the first time, as Cyrus said, about 6 months ago. And I was blown away with what I saw. The culture, the energy, the quality of the people, the attitude, the drive for success,
the warmth, and the commonality of interest to work not only for the benefit of China, but for the benefit of the relationship between China and America. There was not one executive that we met with, and we met with probably two dozen, whose first position was not stated to be, let's find ways to work together for our two countries. I have long believed, and believe even more firmly today, that China is our most important partner in the world.
Yes.
And after tonight, I realized that the Chinese are really Jewish. So.
Wrong. We call it Jewish.
I think that we need each other, China and America, for security, for economics, for cultural exchange and for development, and to protect the planet. Because together we can do it, apart we can't. And one of the reasons that I am so thrilled and honored to be here this evening is because of the fine work that this institute is doing and bringing to all of us in America and in China the awareness of how important this relationship is. Years ago, I met C.H. Tong, who was then either the informal or formal sort of liaison between the Chinese and the American business community. And he said to me back then, this is a relationship that we must build for the future of the world. And it is coming more vividly aware to all of us every day. And I would just like to commit to the China Institute that, first of all, I just want to say one other thing before I forget. I have never felt so warm and comfortable at an event that I've ever been to in my life. So I thank you very, very much for making me feel so, thank you, so good and welcoming and generous. And I think that is one of the unique attributes of the Chinese people that that is so important to us in America and to the world. And I would just like to commit myself here this evening to do everything I can on behalf of the Institute and myself and our entities to do anything I can to bring about a continued and growing relationship between the two countries. I thank you very, very much. I really, truly appreciate this. And I love you.
Welcome, Ron Perlman, to the world of China.
This is something. Ron Perlman is an amazing human being. We are, China Institute, we are really very honored that he's here, to be honored. Our second honoree is Vera Wang. I remember I interviewed Vera Wang for my TV show in the 80s when she first started her own brand. She's laughing right now over there. I was fascinated. I was fascinated by this very brave young woman, Chinese woman no less. You see, in those days, there was no Chinese brand, let alone Chinese designers. Then, of course, from then to now, a lot has happened. Today, Vera is everywhere in the world. She's one of the few people whose website, when you get on it, will ask you, which country of Vera Wang would you like to get to? Try it. Go to verawang.com. But no matter how big Vera has become today, something's never changed. She is just as the first day I met her, still a kind accommodating, generous, and extremely gracious woman. We are very, very proud of her. Very proud of her being Chinese too. And thank you very much for taking this honor. Let's take a look at a video about Mira.
I think what I have brought to fashion in my own way is an attitude, which is I really want to encourage, not dictate. And by that I mean I want to encourage every single woman to explore who she is and how she wants to look and to feel that freedom and that creativity and that fun, that sense of joy and fun that fashion will bring to their lives. It's not just about sitting in a design room where you're dreaming. It's about the attitude that, of course, being a woman designer for other women is such a special journey because I relate to clothing in a personal way on a whole other level. I feel that women are sensual creatures. I feel that clothes should make them feel that way. I don't care if it's a great pea coat, the way they wear it should have attitude and they should feel comfortable in it. Because to me, fashion is about attitude. It's not only about clothing and accessories. It's how it affects a woman and how she feels when she's in it. These are all personal journeys. To me, when a woman understands who she is and who she isn't, then she can really create a style for herself that's authentic. I think I'm very lucky because I do design in so many domains. No matter what the product is, it's who is the woman you're thinking of. It's not just about the clothing or the accessories. Who is that person and how do you make them look their best? I think that's what makes the entire design process and the journey complete, is that it says a lot about the woman, and that to me is what design really is about.
Thank you, Cy, for that lovely introduction, and you honored me with your presence. And thank you, Didi, for presenting me with this incredible award. My personal gratitude should also go out to my dear friend, who's not here tonight, I didn't realize, Miranda Chang, whose grace and dignity know no bounds. Gala Chair Mehi, I hope I'm pronouncing this correct because I do speak Mandarin, but I hope I'm pronouncing correctly. And of course, the China Institute. President James Himovitz, I don't want to make a Jewish joke, but I did ask him when I arrived tonight, how did you get involved with the Chinese? And he was so adorable. And of course, the Board of Trustees. And finally, my fellow honorees, Ronald Perlman, very dear friend, Robert Zhao, I hope I'm presenting that correctly, and Nin Yang. Congratulations to such an extraordinary and deserving group of individuals. Being here tonight reminds me of so many things, but most of all, my own personal history. Growing up in the United States, it was my parents, Chen Qing and Florence, who encouraged me to embrace American culture while never allowing me to forget my Chinese heritage. That delicate balance was what provided my brother Ken and I with such a unique view of the world and a sincere appreciation for both cultures. As the Chinese Institute expresses so beautifully and succinctly in its mission statement, bridging the United States and China by sharing insights and deepening trust through pillars of education, culture, and business. And trust, for me, is a significant word. As someone who has witnessed so much this half a century, these many decades, and realize the opportunities I was afforded, China Institute embodies that and way more, and truly reflects everything I was so fortunate to have experienced in my lifetime. And for that, I will always be grateful. The world we once knew has changed radically. However, today, there is an even greater need for deeper thought, open communication, and true authenticity. Respect for others is the only way I know to create a safer, happier, and more prosperous future. China Institute has always been the forefront of these ideals, the significance of which we must all embrace, not just for our generation, but those that follow in our footsteps. It is our duty. You are all part of that journey. I am so honored to be honored by all of you here tonight, and I thank you for this incredible recognition. Thank you.
Okay, now I would like to introduce you to our Vice Chair of China Institute, Anna Chang.
Hello, again. It's hard to follow Silas, Ron, Vera, USI, but I'm going to try. Our next Blue Card Award honoree is Robert Hong Xiao. Many of you may not be familiar with his name, but you may be very familiar with his company, Perfect World. He is the CEO of Perfect World, a giant in the world of online gaming. One of the largest gaming companies in China, with products exported to more than 100 countries and regions around the world, he is best known in China, but best known amongst your children. You ask them if you know any of those games, they would know what Robert is providing them. Most importantly, since he became CEO in 2012, Robert has built Perfect World from an ordinary Chinese public company into a global enterprise representing the highest level of online games in China. He is also driving a cutting-edge innovation with the opening of a series of research institutes in China. He's very interested in studying the brain, and in fact, he had a series of lectures and studies collaboration with Columbia University to understand the brain of elderly. He's also pursuing a next generation internet entertainment technology research institute, a digital arts institute, a global digital entertainment development research center, and a China Digital Arts Association. The purpose of these new centers of digital innovation is to train new talent in digital entertainment and promote an industrial and technological revolution in innovation in digital entertainment. Finally, Robert is extremely philanthropic and has brought Perfect World to a leadership position in Chinese corporate social responsibility. The Perfect World Employee Foundation makes charitable contributions to public welfare works and projects including disaster relief, helping dropout and disabled children, and building Perfect World villages in the poor areas of Yunnan province. With a PhD from the University of Southern California, Robert is deeply committed to cross-cultural understanding. I personally know that Robert really cares about U.S.-China relations, and in fact, when I asked him, what brings you to New York? Do you have business here? He said, no, most of his business is on the West Coast,
but he really wanted to be here to receive the award and to really be a role model to promote U.S.-China relations. I believe he literally embodies China Institute's mission of building bridges between the U.S. and China. And please turn your attention to the screen for a video about Robert.
Founded in 2004, Perfect World Company Limited has exported its multiple entertainment contents to more than 100 countries and regions, and has set up more than 20 subsidiaries in operation in North America, Europe, and Asia. Perfect World has become the largest movie and game conglomerate ever in China. In the film and TV industry, Perfect World Pictures has filmed many award-winning movies and produces around 500 episodes of TV series every year, which accounts for over 10% of primetime TV in China. TV series of Perfect World Pictures were offered to Argentina as national gifts by President Xi during his visit in 2014. For Games Center, Perfect World Games has successfully developed and released multiple quality games and operated many globally known esports titles in China. For several continual years, Perfect World Games has won first place in China's Game Expo with the leading superiority. As the CEO of the company, Dr. Shao has delivered speeches and joined discussions at multiple major international conferences, such as the World Economic Forum, Boao Forum for Asia, APEC Summits, and World Internet Conference. He speaks for the rising cultural and creative industry and contributes insights to the development of world economy and social harmony and stability. In the future, Dr. Shao will always devote himself to multicultural exchanges and mutual learning, focus on creating and spreading happiness to the public.
Just arrived from China last night, so it was a little jet lag. Oh, this afternoon, sorry. This is great form. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Alan. Thank you very much. And thank you, Mr. Bay, our chairman. And thank you, James, my friend. And thank you for the Board of Trustees here. I'm a little dizzy still, but try to remember what I'm supposed to say. We are a young company compared to many successful businesses here in the United States. You know, I'm thrilled to receive this award, be recognized. This is not about me, obviously. This is about, I guess, a generation of different business people from China who wanted to reach out to the world and to do something more than just earning profit and generating good business returns. I think it's been very inspirational, you know, in listening to whatever Ronald has been saying and doing. You know, this is, I probably need to dig a little bit more and understand how, you know, leaders like Ronald can become a leader, not only in the business, but also in philanthropic activities. And Vera, of course, you know, I'm a fan of you always. And other really distinguished honorees. I'm thrilled. And, I think what we have been doing, it's something probably new, besides some of the successes in the businesses around the world. What we were trying to do are twofold. One is on the education for youth, especially for youngsters in China, because we all know there are many poor, very poor places in the remote areas of China. We not only donate money, we not only help them to build schools, but also we send people. We are an entertainment firm, so we have a lot of talent. We send our talent to go to, you know, to do some voluntary work by teaching kids the art. This is well received, and our employees are really appreciating this because, you know what, even in poor places, people are honored to be able to help other people. We witnessed that. I've been visiting a lot of poor places, visiting young kids, and I'm deeply moved every time I'm there. The second poll we've been trying to do is probably related to my background. I want to really promote a lot of culture exchanges, bilateral, multilateral, exchanges by people. We're business people, so we don't do much. We can't do much in political things. We understand that the world need to be peacefully developed. And understanding between cultures, between nations, between ethnic groups, very important. So what we're trying to do always is to utilize our resources to help different people from different countries, from different, you know, religious backgrounds, get together and understand each other, exchange the best part of their own culture. I believe we haven't done much yet. There are a lot of more to do, and I'm very, very lucky and I feel honored to be able to get involved with China Institute with good people like this and, you know, try to work together to make good things happen for both China and the U.S. Because, you know, sitting today, getting this reward is not the end. It definitely is a start. And I think we need to join force. We need to work together. A lot of people are asking me what Perfect World means. Angela was asking me, you know, how she could get into Perfect World. Everybody wants to live in a perfect world. Obviously, I said, we're not perfect. Nobody is perfect. Our company is not perfect at all. But I always think, if we can work together, we can join force. We have our heart together. We can always make this world truly perfect. Thank you very much. Thank you.
I have the honor to, since you already know me, I don't need to be introduced, but I have the honor to introduce the next honoree, the next and last honoree, Ning Yuan, whom I know, of course, as Yuan Ning. But Yuan Ning is at the very forefront of China's efforts to create world-class multinational companies that are operating in markets all across the world. China State Construction and Engineering Corporation is the largest construction company in the world. So of course, in my business as an architect, I run into them all the time. They have built my buildings in many, many cities, in Beijing, in Qingdao, even in Washington. CCA participated in the project that we did in Washington. China Construction America has become a major player in the U.S. infrastructure and high-end building market. CCA has sustained an annual growth rate of more than 40%. I think even Mr. Perlman would be impressed with numbers like that. From constructing buildings for Chinese diplomatic missions to undertaking projects for Chinese companies operating overseas, from providing turnkey construction solutions to public and private clients, to participating in projects through investment and financial consulting, CCA has opened a path to continue expanding its business and partnering with American companies to explore opportunities overseas. At CCA, Ningyuan has embraced far-sighted localization strategy, incorporating elements of both Eastern and Western management approaches for leadership. CCA's commitment to long-term partnership and integrity has been a major contributor to CCA's success, offering valuable lessons to other Chinese companies interested in entering the U.S. market. But Ningyuan's contributions extend far beyond the realm of pure business acumen. Through both his CCA business and his work at the Chinese General Chamber of Commerce, Ningyuan has helped to promote dialogue and exchange between Chinese and U.S. business leaders. This kind of collaboration and dialogue between Chinese and American businesses provides crucial non-government linkages that help ensure that the U.S. and China continue to work together to find solutions for mutual challenges. I would also like to add that we are extremely happy to welcome Ningyuan as a new member of our Board of Trustees. So his contributions go well beyond just the business part. So I invite you to look at the video, and then we'll meet Ningyuan.
Ningyuan, Chairman and President of China Construction America, China State Construction Engineering Corporation's largest overseas subsidiary, is a veteran in international construction and investment. Shouldering the largest investment and construction group CSCEC's global vision, Mr. Yuan has dedicated his entire career to the company's overseas development. Mr. Yuan successfully transformed CCA from a small Chinese contractor of just 12 employees to a multinational company in the Americas. Under Mr. Yuan's leadership, the company has maintained an average annual growth rate of over 55% in the past decade, and more than 98% of its employees are local hires. Today, CCA is recognized as the 10th largest bridge contractor and the second largest builder in South Florida and fourth largest in New York City. Due to Mr. Yuan, CSCEC's first international acquisition came when CCA purchased Plaza Construction in 2014, which has enhanced CSCEC's global presence significantly and put the company in a more competitive position in the United States. China Construction America has also successfully expanded into the Caribbean and Latin American markets with a strong presence in the Bahamas and Panama. Mr. Yuan initiated and succeeded in establishing CCA's investment and development platform to serve the company's business expansion in the Americas. In addition to being a successful businessman, Mr. Yuan is a keen educator, committed to supporting quality education, and the initiator of all CCA's charitable activities. Mr. Yuan travels to many prestigious universities to mentor young talents with his industry expertise, inspirational vision. Mr. Yuan served as the third and fourth chairman of China General Chamber of Commerce in the United States, and he is a passionate supporter of a healthy and comprehensive China-U.S. relationship, making significant contributions to bilateral economic exchanges.
Thank you, Didi, for your kind words. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm humbled and honored to accept this award and to join the other four honorees who have made incredible contribution to China-U.S. relations. It gives me great pleasure and honor to work alongside all of you to advance this extremely important bilateral relationship in the world. To China Institute, thank you for this award and for the wonderful opportunity to get together and renew our friendship and commitment to a healthy and productive U.S.-China relationship. I also want to express my gratitude to all those present or not who have helped and supported me over the years. It takes more than one lock to prop up a house. So thank you for being there for me along the way. Last but not least, I'd like to thank each and every one of the 2,000 CCA employees. Without their hard work and dedication, CCA could hardly have reached where it is now. I know Didi and James will back me up on this as CCA's subsidiary, Plaza Construction, has just completed China Institute's new headquarters. In Chinese, we say, 不忘初心方得始终, meaning that staying true to your original aspiration will lead you to success. As China has entered a new era of going out, let's stay true, press on, for a better and more prosperous future that benefits both China and the United States. Thank you.
Before you leave us, shall we ask the sisters to come back and sing one more song for us? After all, they flew all this way, right? We better do that. Hermie.
今天的雪莲三姐妹选择了青藏高原作为她们的压轴的歌曲。青藏高原是一首特别经典的歌曲。
Our last song by the sister is called Tibetan Plateau. It is one of the most popular Tibetan folk songs. Almost every Chinese can sing it. So if you know it, please join in the singing. Let's welcome the Tibetan Snow Lotus Trio.
Thank you.
And dessert, but I just wanted to say, in addition to my angel trustees who helped co-chair tonight, Yisai and Kume, to my chair, Didi, to my vice chair, Anla Chung, and to all of you, a big thank you for coming. And before I forget, one person we haven't thanked yet is all the hardworking staff at China Institute. Everybody that's here working, whether they're collecting gift cards, or whether it's my Chief Development Officer, Andrea Severino Gallen, who worked so hard to make this evening a success. Thank you all for coming, and please enjoy and stay.